the curettage method for benign bone tumors. And you know, so I have tried and incorporated practically everything about curettage, and let it be a very informal kind of talk. You can interrupt me anytime and ask me questions. All right. Okay. Is the screen visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
All right, fine, good. So benign bone tumors are commonly seen in kids and young individuals. It's very rare to find benign bone tumors in an individual who is beyond 40 years or 45 years of age. And the treatment is primarily intralesional curettage with the aim of preserving as much function as possible. So what are the common and benign bone tumors who we treat with curettage? Or we used to treat with curettage? I mean, the list is very long, but these are the common entities that I've included: GCTs, chondroblastomas, aneurysmal and simple bone cysts, osteosteomas, osteoblastoma, chondromyxoid fibroma, desmoplastic fibroma, intraosseous hemangioma, non-ossifying fibroma, fibrous dysplasia, enchondroma. So these are the, you know, common benign tumors which were traditionally been treated with curettage. But if you see, you know, there has been a paradigm shift in the treatment of majority of these tumors, wherein, you know, chondroblastomas, osteosteomas, osteoblastomas, we now treat with IFAs. ABCs, we treat with percutaneous sclerotherapy. Simple bone cysts, we treat with intralesional steroids. And, you know, we realize that hemangiomas or NOFs, fibrous dysplasias, and chondromas really don't need any surgery, any treatment, or active intervention. We can just observe them. And if they progress, then over a period of time, we can do a surgery or treat them. So it leaves us with practically, you know, a GCT, chondromyxoid fibromas, and desmoplastic fibromas, which are still primarily a surgical problem, and we have to treat them with surgery. Having said that, the incidence of CMF and DPF are extremely rare. So we are left with a giant cell tumor wherein we are doing surgeries practically for every GCTs. And we know that all this, as I said, this is a disease of young individual, and that is why the aim is to preserve the joints. So the management philosophy of all the benign bone tumors, especially GCT, is to do a function preserving intralesional surgery, meaning by removing the tumor from within the cavity, and avoid a morbid resection. So basically, we are looking at two different type of surgical management. One is intralesional curettage, that means scooping out of the disease with a curette, followed by an appropriate reconstruction. The advantage is that you are preserving the natural joint, but the disadvantage is that you leave behind microscopic disease irrespective of whatever you do. And the local recurrence rates were reported in the range of 27 to 58% in the traditional literature, which is clearly unacceptable. Vis-a-vis, if you do a marginal or wide excision, that means you remove the tumor completely without opening it. That means you resect the neighboring joint and you lose that joint, you put in a prosthesis, or you put in a, you fuse the joint, and that has its own sequelae over a long time. But the advantage is that it gives you an excellent disease control. So as I said, the traditional treatment of GCT, you know, the local recurrence rates reported in the literature at 2 years were unacceptably high if you look at the older literature, in the range of 40 to 60%. But if you look at a recent literature, you know that now the recent literature says that the recurrence rates have gone down to less than 10%. So what has caused this dramatic change? It is because the conventional curettage is out, and what we do nowadays is known as extended curettage. So what is extended curettage? That we will come to, but later on. Before that, we should know what are the indications of curettage, especially in a giant cell tumor. So clinically, you have to examine the patient. If the patient's range of movement around the neighboring joint is good and free and painless, that means the articular cartilage is probably normal. On X-ray, on MRI and CT scan, the articular cartilage should look healthy. There should not be any pre-existing arthritis. The cortical bone should be good, which should allow a good mechanical burring against those cortical bone. And there should be adequate structural stability after curettage to support the reconstruction. That means presence of soft tissue mass or pathological fracture, or if the case is a recurrent case, is per se not a contraindication for curettage. If the other criteria are matched, which were just narrated. So what are the contraindications of curettage? The contraindication is damaged articular cartilage or a pre-existing osteoarthritis, like in these cases which I have put in, or if there is a large soft tissue component, you know, irrespective of whatever you do, you are going to be unable to clear this disease. If there is a cortical break with soft tissue component in more than one tissue plane, or if there is no cortical bone to support the reconstruction. Now these are the cases where you can't do a curettage irrespective of whatever you think. If the patient has multiple pathological fractures like this, you know, there are pathological fractures inside the joint and outside the joints. I mean, there is nothing that you can do for these patients. You have to just go for a resection. Or if the disease is involving expandable bones like proximal fibula, proximal radius, distal ulna, or lateral end of clavicle, or sternum, or manubrium, these are the places where you don't, you don't really need to do a curettage, risk a recurrence, because these are expandable bones. So what is the extended curettage? What do you mean by extended curettage? It is that you make a big window. I mean, nowadays we say don't make windows, make doors, so that you have 360 degree vision of the cavity. We use variety of scopes with different sizes and different angulations. You use adjuvants like hydrogen peroxide, you use high speed burr, you can use chemicals like phenol and absolute alcohol, or you can use spray mode electrocauterization or argon laser as an adjuvant to extend your intralesional margins. So there can be three type of adjuvants. One is mechanical adjuvant, that means you can use high speed burr or that pulse lavage. The chemical adjuvants are hydrogen peroxide, phenol, ethanol, and the cement, methyl methacrylate. The thermal adjuvants are electrocautery, bone cement, argon beam, and liquid nitrogen. Okay. So let us look at all the aspects of extended curettage one by one. So say, for example, this is a giant cell tumor in the distal end of femur, which is the commonest site. So what you do, you make a small window first and then take out the gross disease. Now you know that, as you know, there are multiple septas, and underneath the septas, there would be tumor which is left behind. So what you have to do, you know, first thing is that you have to expand the cavity or the window so that you have 360 degree vision. Then you have to have an adequate light in your operation theater, you know, so that, you know, you have to have at least two lights coming in from different angles so that you are, all the entire cavity walls are under your direct vision. Use, you know, a nibbler and take out all these septas so that you can do a gross curettage properly. Once you are done with the gross curettage, you know that this walls is still harboring the microscopic disease. So what you do, you take a high speed burr and further burr the things by 3 to 5 millimeters. Then you can use phenol, you take it on a peanut and apply it to all the walls, or you can use electrocauterization, or you can use argon laser, or you can use all of them. Once you're done with that, you give a proper lavage, and that is where your extended curettage is complete. So the first question, how big should be the window? Let us see this case. This is a GCT of distal end of femur. Okay, so your window should be this much big. Your window should be extending from the superior to inferior extent of the tumor. So this is where you will make this bigger window so that there is no nooks and corners which are beyond your vision, and that is where you can do a nice curettage and cementing. If you have these kind of walls which are infiltrated by the tumors, when you see that your cortex is deformable, you know that is infiltrated by the tumor, and you need to take out that much part of the cortex. When you have, sometimes you have this kind of disease where it is Campanacci 3 GCT, that means the disease has already broken out of the cortex. That doesn't mean you cannot do a curettage if the articular cartilage is good, as in this particular patient. What you do is this, you see this MR, there is a large soft tissue mass all around, as you can see, but the articular cartilage is very good. So what you do is the entire non-articular part of this ballooned out cortex can be removed in one piece like this. And then you can extend the window to the extent that all these walls are then completely bony, any part of the cortex which is softened or which is already damaged by the giant cell tumor should be removed. And then you can do a suitable reconstruction and patient can have a long-term disease-free functional outcome. So the length of the window should be big enough to expose the complete supra-inferior extent of the disease, and it should give 360-degree vision to the surgeon. Coming to the use of high-speed burr, now we all know that high-speed burr is the most important and integral part of extended curettage. You know, this is a pre-burring cavity. You have done a nice scoping, but you know, this entire walls are still harboring a microscopic disease, and then you do this kind of a burring. Okay, typically it should be more than 35,000 RPM. RPM speed of more than 35,000 RPM, and after the curettage you can see the difference between the two cavities. All this red part, which is probably harboring all the tumor tissue. So as I said, the only adjuvant which has stood to the test of time and all the research is high speed burring. You know, a curettage is not complete if you have not used a high speed burr. You can avoid using phenol, alcohol, you can avoid using electrocauterization or argon beam, but you cannot avoid high-speed burring. Now, if you look at this landmark paper where they have compared patients where only burr was used versus those patients where burr plus other adjuvants were used, and you could see that the local recurrence rates are absolutely similar. So, addition of other adjuvants did not improve the disease-free, disease control in the giant cell tumor. This is another paper which has actually compared curettage group versus resection group. And they have concluded that whenever during the curettage, whenever the burr was used, the recurrence rates were as good as much as resection group. That means they were no worse than the resection. So if you use high speed burr, your disease control rate is as good as doing a resection. Coming to the chemicals, we know that hydrogen peroxide, again, just like burr, hydrogen peroxide has been considered as an integral part of the curettage. Why? One, it is itself, it inhibits giant cell tumor and osteoblast metabolism in vitro, that we all know. But it is also a cleansing agent. You know, whenever you are using hydrogen peroxide, it gives you a very nice and clean feel. It also adds up in hemostasis. But it has never been investigated as an isolated agent. So we don't know whether, you know, that is really causing any improvement in the disease control. Coming to the more debated and more controversial agent, that is phenol. Now, this, if you look at this paper, it clearly states that even after addition of phenol, it does not improve the disease-free, disease control of in the GCT curettage group. Now, this is another paper which says that despite the different rates of recurrence noted in the literature, this study suggests that the local recurrence rates of GCT located in long bones treated with or without phenol is absolutely similar. But if you look at this paper, these people say that phenolization is a very effective and safe local adjuvant therapy for GCT. Again, this is another paper which reported only 6% of local recurrence rates, and they have always used phenol in all the cases along with burr and cement, and they have strongly recommended that phenol should be used in every case. So the world is divided over use of phenol. I myself use phenol, but I know many of my colleagues, they don't use phenol. And practically all of us have reported equivalent recurrence rates. But if you have to use the phenol, what should be the concentration of phenol? You know, people have studied 6% versus 70% versus 80% concentration of phenol. And what they have concluded is that all you need is a 6% phenol solution, and it should have 3 minutes or more of contact time with the cortices, and that is good enough. You really don't need to use higher concentration. It actually is detrimental because it increases the risk of bone necrosis and systemic intoxication. So you should avoid using higher dosages. So what is the method of using phenol? Phenol is available, whenever it is available in amber colored bottle. It is usually available in a crystalline form. You have to actually put the bottle in a warm saline bucket that will, leak. Part of it will liquefy, then you take it on peanuts and you apply it to all the walls. Make sure that while you are applying it on the walls, you keep sucking it with the suction cannula, you don't want the phenol to spill out in the soft tissue because it can be really dangerous. And once the, your contact time of 3 minutes is over, you have to wash it out with absolute alcohol. Why? Because phenol, body does not have any mechanism to excrete phenol, you know, and so alcohol is actually, phenol is actually carbolic acid and alcohol is ethyl alcohol. So it is actually a natural antidote of phenol. And secondly, it itself is tumoricidal. So it's like a double-edged sword, you know, you can, with alcohol, you have better disease control and you neutralize the toxic effect of phenol. Coming to, you know, the thermal adjuvants. And what are the thermal adjuvants? Electrocauterization or argon laser. You know, electrocautery has been found to be very effective, as some papers reported 0% local recurrence rate with the use of electrocautery. Now, it basically is a, it causes coagulation necrosis of tumor tissue. So you put the cautery on spray mode and you use around 100 or 120 power, and then you, you know, char all the walls of the cavity, and that will probably kill all the tumor tissue. This is the argon laser. Laser, the advantage of argon laser is that it has a very nice flame. This has got a very, very nice flame, and it doesn't cause as much burning as compared to electrocautery. It has more controlled you know, distribution of the heat, but it is a very expensive kind of instrument which is not available in all the setups. And we have found out that electrocautery is as good, if not better. Electrocauterization is especially good for these kind of places where there is a cortical breach. You can't really use your burr very effectively. And this is where, you know, your electrocautery will certainly help you. With the electrocauterization, you can actually do cauterization of, spray mode cauterization of all these soft tissue extensions. And you can have a good disease control. So let us see a complete video of Curetta. This is a distal end of radius GCT. Most of the times the cortex is so weak that you can actually take out the cortex with just help of the scissor. Make sure that your surroundings are covered with hydrogen peroxide soaked gauze pieces before you make the window, because you want to avoid the soft tissue spillage. Now with the variety of scopes, you take out the gross tumor tissue. As you can see here, you can take out the gross tumor tissue. You do a primary wash with hydrogen peroxide. All these things, and then most of the orthopedic surgeons would start thinking of reconstruction here and saying that, okay, my curettage is over. But this is where actually our part, extended curettage, will start. This is the, with the help of high speed burr, you do burring of each and every nooks and corners. And this is how it starts looking. Then you put your cautery on. I typically use pre mode cautery and add the 100 power on the coagulation mode. Do cauterization of each walls, all the nooks and corners, especially those areas where the cortex has been weakened and you can't really use your burr very aggressively. This is the place where, you know, in this particular case, we have to use it. Now I will take I will do phenolization. This is how the liquefied phenol is taken on a peanut, and you know, and then it is put in the cavity. As you can see, and then this is absolute alcohol with which we can do a wash. This is where your curettage is complete, extended curettage. This is how beautiful it will look. And thinking of reconstruction with whatever you think, as in cement, with cement in this particular case. So we usually combine all three modalities, that is burr, cauterization, and phenolization. And we have found out that our local recurrence rates have been extremely competitive. Our local recurrence rate is just 5% in more than 180 cases that we have treated at 2.5 to 3 years of follow-up. If you compare it with all the other series in the literature, the local recurrence rates are always in the in double figures. Only one paper from Malawar where they've used burr and cement, they have got the local recurrence rate of 8%. Coincidentally, the only paper I could find in literature with 0% recurrent rate has used all three. You know, they have used curettage, electrocautery, boring, and phenol irrigation and cementation in all particular cases. So once you're done with the curettage, you're left with this kind of a cavity. Now you divide the cavity according to the type of cartilage and subchondral bone that you got after the curettage. So when you got more than 2 millimeter of subchondral bone and the cartilage is strong, that is known as type A defect. When the subchondral bone is less than 2 millimeters, but the cartilage is still strong, it is non-deformable, it is known as type B cartilage. And when you don't have any subchondral bone left, the cartilage is thin, is deformable, is soft, it is like a ping pong ball, and maybe sometimes there are rents in it, it is known as type C cartilage. And your reconstruction would depend on what type of cartilage you are left behind with. So this is a typical example of type A defect, where you can see a nice thick subchondral bone here, as you can see. So here after the curettage, all I need to do is to put in a fibula struts and not allow the cavity to collapse. And you can expect a nice filling of the entire cavity with new bone, and you can have an excellent function. This kind of reconstruction, you have to be very careful with your mobilization, because you know this mobilization may be delayed. Now this particular girl was very young, she was only 19, and that is where we could afford to do this. This is another example of type A defect. Here we have done cementation. The advantage is that we have allowed the patient to mobilize on day one. So whenever the type A defect is there, you could either use graft or use cement and be okay with any of them. But this is the patient with classical type B defect, where there is no, very little subchondral bone left. This is where we do something which is known as sandwich reconstruction. That means the subchondral bone is reinforced with iliac crest bone grafts, and the rest of the cavity is filled up with cement with a layer of gel foam in between. So as you can see, this is iliac crest, this is cement, and this thin line, the radiolucent line, is the where we have put in gel foam. So this is a layered reconstruction, that is what is known as sandwich reconstruction. As you can see, this is a 10-year follow-up of the same lady, an excellent outcome. So whenever the disease, we have got type B defect, that is where we try to reinforce the articular cartilage with the help of bone graft, and the rest of the cavity we reconstruct with help of cement. This is known as sandwich reconstruction. But this is a type C defect. As you can see, there is a large soft tissue mass here, and there is practically inexistent subchondral bone. This is the cavity when after curettage, you will see something like this. You know, the cartilage is collapsing, there is a rent in the cartilage, it is so soft that it's like a, you know, there is practically only a layer of cartilage like a papad. This is where, you know, if you do any sort of, if you do a sandwich reconstruction or something, your cartilage is going to collapse because there is nothing underneath that to hold it. So here, the primary goal is to maintain the articular congruity with the help of a rigid structure underneath it, like cement. So this is the case where, you know, you have to reconstruct this with cement, and this will give you a long lasting and stable reconstruction. So your primary goal should not be, you know, give a biological reconstruction, but to maintain the articular congruity. There is another advantage of using cement. We all know it's a globally accepted and acknowledged fact that using cement reduces the local recurrence rates because of its coagulative thermal necrosis. I mean, because of the hyperthermia that it creates while setting, and also the polymer that we use is cytotoxic. So this is the paper which talked about 294 patients where the recurrence rate was only 20% while using cement, but it was 56% when they used bone graft. There's another paper which says that curettage and bone grafting had higher recurrence rate as compared to wide dissection as well. And when PMMA cement used, the recurrence rates were similar to that of resection. This is a contemporary paper with large meta-analysis over 1300 patients, which talked about, you know, use of cement, and it clearly said that using cement reduces the local recurrence rates. But whenever you are using cement, you have to be also careful about certain things. Like whenever you are using cement and you are cementing a very large cavity, you have to be worried of this kind of a supracondylar fracture. So whenever the disease is involving more than half of the bone width and it is reaching up to the supracondylar area, it is wise to reinforce the cement bone junction with the titanium plate to prevent the cement bone junction pathological fracture. Even if there is a tamponade 3 GCT, you could do a curetta. This is a nice, there is a large GCT with a tamponade 3. There is the anterior cortex of the tibia has been eroded. As you can see, there is a large mass in the front. What you could do, what we do is, you resect the entire soft tissue mass and convert the tamponade 3 into tamponade 1 or 2. So this is exactly what was done here. You resect the entire soft tissue mass till all the, the borders of the cavity were completely bony. Then you do a variety of extended curettage and then you reconstruct it with a cement. Here we have to do a gastrocnemius flap reconstruction to reconstruct the extensor mechanism, and you can expect a very good function here. As you can see here, this patient has an excellent mechanism, extensor mechanism. Even for recurrent GCT, it doesn't mean if the GCT is recurrent that you have to do a resection. This is a patient who had a lower end of femur GCT, underwent a curettage and cementing, and presented to us with a large recurrent swelling in the soft tissue as well as in the bone. Again, the same thing, the same logic that, though there is a tamponade 3 component, the articular cartilage looks very good. There was no posterior disease. Patient had excellent clinical range of movement. And that is why we went ahead and did an extended curettage, cement, cementing and intramedullary pinning to reinforce the cement bone junction. Now, this patient had a pathological fracture, intra-articular pathological fracture here. That also doesn't mean that you cannot do a curettage here. The principle of curettage remains same. You make a large window, do a proper curettage, but here you have to do an arthrotomy and see the articular cartilage. You have to reduce it with multiple K-wires because there is no subchondral bone. All you can do is you can hold it temporarily with multiple K-wires. And then reinforce the cavity with cement. Now the cement itself will keep the fragments in reduced position. So this is where, this is a key to it. Whenever you have an intra-articular pathological fracture, your aim is a rigid fixation and immediate mobilization, because if you don't do that, your patients will have a bad stiffness. Many of these patients undergo intra-articular non-union, but they are usually asymptomatic. This boy actually had a large GCT. He sustained a pathological fracture while doing painting and draping. But again, it did not make us change our plan. We did a nice curettage. We made a window. We did all type of burring, electrocauterization, phenolization, alcoholization. Then we put in a plate. And then again, we reinforced with cement. The idea is that cement will help you hold the fragments in position because there is no bone left here. So if you rely on the bone, if you put any sort of bone, then in that situation, it is likely to collapse. And that is why you have to reinforce it with cement. Now, this is a long-term follow-up, almost 6.5 years since his surgery, and he is doing extremely well. All right. So, I hope I have covered practically everything. Thank you very much. I have covered the methods of curettage, and I've also covered the method of reconstructing a cavity. Now, I'm happy to take any questions if you have.
Thank you so much, sir. It was so nicely explained that being non-orthopedic surgeons, still we could understand it clearly.
Thank you very much.
And sir, few questions like,
yes,
what are the principles of biopsy in germ cell tumors? Giant cell.
The biopsy principle itself is a very long talk in itself. Of course, unlike many carcinomas, it is very important that you do the biopsy of a sarcoma or any musculoskeletal tumor, understanding its principle very well. Because unlike carcinomas, sarcomas, they like to seed. And we know that the biopsy tract is a zone of contamination. And whenever you are doing a surgery, preparative surgery, you have to excise that part along with your specimen. That may not be true for giant cell tumor when you are planning an interventional curettage. But when you are doing a biopsy, you actually don't know whether it's a GCT or it's a malignancy. And that is why you have to still follow the same principles. Okay. So typically the principles of biopsy is that we use a Jamshedi needle. The patient is always under anesthesia. Patient is always in the operation theater. We have a CM guidance. We put the needle inside the cavity and then we take out a sample with the help of heparinized syringe. Should I show a video?
Sure, sure.
Yeah, just let me just see. Just a second. I'll show a video of biopsy here. Just a second. All right. Let me first share my screen. Okay, I'll share the screen. Okay, is my screen visible?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
All right. So this is a, so what we typically do is this. Sorry, so I'll again start from here. So what we do is we take a 20cc syringe. I've taken heparin in it. This is a Jamshedi needle. So then the syringe, Jamshedi needle and the saline is all heparinized. You put the needle inside the cavity and then you attach that heparinized syringe to the Jamshedi needle, maintain a negative suction and keep sucking. So along with blood, a lot of tissue will come. Then you filter that thing, that saline, and the sediment is your material for biopsy. Understand? It's a very easy and simple procedure. What is important is how to do the biopsy, what lesions to be biopsied, when to biopsy, who should do the biopsy, why the biopsy is important, all these things. So biopsy itself is a very long lecture, long talk, and it has to be understood very properly by all of you. You understand?
So, sir, in GCT, can we upfront go for curettage, or we need?
No, you can't. You can't. You have to do a biopsy in every case. You know, without doing a biopsy, you should never go for curettage. Because you know there are so many cases where you know the surgeon thought that this is a GCT. He went ahead, did a curettage, and it's turned out to be a sarcoma. And then it's a mess, total mess, because a curated sarcoma has very poor outcome, not only for limb but also for overall. I mean for life. I mean they have a poorer outcome that we all know from the literature. That's an evidence that we have. And what do you lose by doing a biopsy? You know, biopsy will exactly tell you what type of tumor you are dealing with. There is no scope of any direct surgery in musculoskeletal oncology today, barring a very, very classical few like osteosteomas or fibrous dysplasias or osteochondromas or hemangiomas, something like that. But even there, we tell the people, we tell all the general orthopedic surgeons, all our listeners all the time, that it is always better to do a biopsy. Even if you're 100% sure that this is a simple bone cyst, what do you lose by putting a needle in and getting a sample? You understand? Because we have seen that, you know, because general orthopedic surgeons or even general oncosurgeons don't really have that much of exposure or training with tumors, because musculoskeletal tumors itself are so rare. You know, so they don't see it every now and then. And it is always wise to be sure that what you're dealing with and then do the final and definitive procedure.
Sure, sir. And the principles of imaging, like do you only go with the X-ray or you do an MR for?
Always X-ray, always MRI with contrast. All right. So these are the two basic investigations even for any benign bone tumors. If you're looking at malignancy, of course, it's altogether a different ballgame, because you have to go for metastatic workup and then maybe a PET scan or maybe CT chest, bone scan, all those things. But for benign bone tumors, X-ray and a contrast enhanced MRI is absolutely must.
And sir, it has also been known to metastasize to the lung. So, is yes. there any role in chemotherapy?
Yes,
and
it's a good question. So, there is no role of chemotherapy. There is no role of, any adjuvants here. It's a benign tumor. But it is known to metastasize to lungs. It is also known to metastasize to other bones, to the lymph nodes, to the brain. It has practically metastasized to every organ in the body. There are multiple case reports. But we all know that around 2% of the giant cell tumors, they metastasize to lungs. And that is why as a staging modality or investigation, we always get an X-ray chest every yearly for all our patients. If the patient has presented to you with after multiple metastasis, multiple recurrences, then we also get a CT chest done because we know that current cases have a higher risk of metastasizing to lungs. If a patient has come to me after two or three recurrences, I will certainly get a HRCT done. But if the patient has been primarily seen by me, first surgery or first time biopsy also done by me, in that case, I just go with the simple X-ray chest. And that should be good enough. After treatment also, on regular follow-up, once in a year, chest X-ray is mandated.
So how do you manage the lung mets after
So lung mets, it depends. So what the literature says is that lung mets, if they are, first thing is that if they should be treated only if they are symptomatic. Okay, that is one thing. Majority of them are asymptomatic. Secondly, it also depends on the number of the metastatic lesions and whether it is symptomatic or not. If the number of metastatic lesions are small, is very less, maybe less than three on either side, you go ahead and do a metastasectomy. That will cure your patient. If the numbers are more, patient is asymptomatic, in that case, you can just put the patient on zoledronic acid once in a month for first 12 months, and then once in 3 months, and then once in 6 months, you will treat the patient for 36 months. If the patient is more symptomatic, then you start with denosumab. Denosumab is a more active in more active molecule, which is against giant cell tumor. And then you can step down to zoledronic acid after a loading dose of around 6 months. So denosumab is very, very effective in treating giant cell tumors.
And sir, is there any role of radiotherapy or brachytherapy as such in these tumors?
No role of brachytherapy for sure. In inoperable giant cell tumor, say for example, there is a giant cell tumor in the sacrum, or if there is a giant cell tumor in the clivus, or if there is a giant cell tumor, in an inoperable area of spine. And so basically, whenever surgery is not possible, radiation therapy is known to be very effective. In that situations, we give patients an ortho voltage, mega voltage radiotherapy. And it is known to control the disease for a pretty long time. But, the hindsight or the complication of radiotherapy is that radiation-induced sarcomas are also very well known. So after giving radiotherapy, especially in the if it is given in more than 50 grays range, there is a chance, around 11% chance of malignant transformation in 15 years. Now, that was more true for older generations of radiation therapy in the sense the ortho voltage radiotherapy. With the mega voltage radiotherapy, that incidence has also gone down dramatically. But the curative treatment for giant cell tumor would always remain surgery. So whenever the surgery is possible, we have to go for surgery. If the surgery is not possible, if it's very morbid, if you have a large GCT in sacrum, if you try and operate it, there are intraoperative chances of intraoperative complications in the form of excessive bleeding and perioperative mortalities. Second thing is that patient might lose bowel and bladder control because of nerve root damage. In these kind of cases, if you are not confident enough that you will be able to do a good surgery, in that case, you can always send the patient for radiotherapy. And radiotherapy is known to be effective in giant cell tumors.
Okay. So thank you so much, sir. It was really a wonderful presentation and we all enjoyed it thoroughly.
Thank you very much.
Look forward to more learning from you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye. All the best.